हेलो फ्रेंड्स, लेट अस टुडे डिस्कस अबाउट अल्टरनेटिव फ्यूल्स फॉर सीआई इंजिन्स। अल्टरनेटिव फ्यूल्स फॉर सीआई इंजिन्स। अर्लियर वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट अल्टरनेटिव फ्यूल्स फॉर एसआई इंजिन्स एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट अल्टरनेटिव फ्यूल्स फॉर CI engines. Now, what are things has to be kept in mind before we discuss about alternative fuels for any engines? We know there are two types. Basically, the engines are there, the SI and the fuel CI engine options. In SI engines, we require higher self-ignition temperature as one of the most important required, which in other words we can say higher C octane number and therefore higher anti-knock quality. Similarly, for CI engines, when we discuss, we say lesser self-ignition temperature will be the requirement and octane number is going to be smaller, and CT number is going to be higher. And when we say CT number is higher, we say higher anti-knock quality of the fuel. So this important difference have to be kept in mind before we moving ahead, because in general we can say that a good SI engine fuel is a bad CI engine fuel, and a good CI engine fuel is a bad SI engine fuel, or vice versa. So that means if a fuel is suitable for one engine, then it will not be comparatively better option for the other engine. That is what you have to keep in mind. And therefore, first let us discuss what are the basic requirements for a CI engine fuels. So we should have less self-ignition temperature. That is one of the most important requirement. That is, the self-ignition temperature should be lesser for CI engine to be considered as a CI engine fuel. The other thing what we call it as is, in terms of its rating, that is, we want high CTN number. Or it is, in other words, less octane number. So this higher CTN number is, in other words, we are saying it is higher anti-knock quality of the CI engine fuel. And moreover, when we discuss about CI engine, we say the self-ignition temperature is lesser, or octane number is also lesser, and higher CTN number is what we want. The self-ignition temperature becomes a very important property over here, because we know that in general we use 16 to 22 as compression ratio in CI engines. And when from this particular point of view, that is where the self-ignition temperature is becoming very important property. So here the self-ignition temperature becomes important. Why it becomes important? Because as the self-ignition temperature is higher, higher the self-ignition temperature, higher will be the compression ratio required for the engine to ensure combustion. That means If you are using fuels of higher self-ignition temperature, then engines will become more bulky. That means it is not that we cannot use higher self-ignition temperature fuels for CI engines, but if at all they are using, then the engines will become more bulky and the feasibility of that particular fuels will be becoming lesser, considered as lesser. So that is where we require fuels of lesser self-ignition temperature. Now let us now list some of the alternatives for CI engine. So alternative fuels for CI engines. So when we list them, very first important is alcohol. It includes both ethyl and methyl alcohol. Second important is the biogas, is again an important alternative for CI engine. Third is the hydrogen. So these are generally important alternative fuels for CI engine, but we do have so many like producer gas, then we have blast furnace gas, we have coke oven gas, and we have obviously biodiesel. Now if you look at this, alcohols are generally liquids, and all this second to sixth, that is biogas, hydrogen, producer gas, blast furnace gas, coke oven gas, all these are gases, and biodiesel is again a liquid. So except 1 and 7th, all are gases. Now when we consider gas as a fuel for CI engine, then the generally CI engine operation, as we know, we are injecting the fuel in the form of droplets, and then we are compressing, initially we are compressing the air, and then at the end of compression we are going to inject the fuel in the form of droplets. But here it is a gas. So whenever we are supplying the gas, then preferably what we have to do is we have to initially mix it with air and we have to supply it to the combustion chamber, and then we have to go for compression. Then here the problem will become that if the self-ignition temperature is very low, then they may ignite at a certain time, or if the self-ignition temperature is very high, then they may not ignite. That is where preferably in case of fuels with a higher self-ignition temperature, they can be also used, but with a option what we call as dual fuel option. That is, for starting the burning, we have to use a diesel, and then we have to use this regular mixture, whatever we have. So this is about the different options for CI engines with respect to alternative fuels. Now let us discuss one by one the different options. So first let us take alcohols. As we know, alcohols are generally having higher self-ignition temperature. They have high self-ignition temperature in the range that is it is greater than 100. Self-ignition temperature is higher compared to that of gasoline, and therefore when it is used with CI engine, SI engine, obviously they are suitable, but they are not suitable, considered to be suitable for because they are generally suitable for SI engine option. SI engines, and therefore not suitable for CI engine. But if at all we want to use for CI engine, then we can use them for CI engines, the compression ratio required may be high. And engine becomes bulky. So that is the issue coming over here again, because we have a higher self-ignition temperature, and to ensure that this fuel is burning, then the compression ratio required will be around 26, 27, that much higher compression ratio will be required. And with this particular compression ratios, the engine may become very bulky. And that is where in general mode, whatever we use as a diesel, we cannot use this particular fuel. And the different modes in which we can use are, one, we have what we call as a dual fuel mode. Second, we have alcohol fumigation. Third, we have alcohol diesel emulsion. And fourth, we have surface ignition of alcohol. So there are many, basically these are the important. Let us discuss what this means. So basically, in a dual fuel mode, what we do is, we prepare a mixture of alcohol and air. So carbureted mixture of air and alcohol is inducted into the engine cylinder, and it is compressed and is burnt by a pilot injection of diesel. So in a general engine will be using it. Obviously, when we compress the mixture of alcohol and air, it is not going to burn because the self-ignition is very high. And obviously, but we want to burn, and therefore what we do, we inject a small quantity, and the quantity is around 5 to 10% of the fuel. So that much quantity we are going to give it in the form of a pilot injection. So when we inject this particular diesel in the pilot injection mode, then it burns, the diesel starts burning. And when diesel starts burning, enough heat is produced, and then the remaining mixture also starts burning. So this is what happens in a dual fuel mode. And this is a very popular mode, and in many of these particular fuels will be burned in the dual fuel mode. Next method what we can have is alcohol fumigation. Here what we do is, again we have alcohol air mixture carbureted And here the amount of alcohol is around 50%. And then we inject diesel, that is remaining 50% at the end of compression stroke. So here we have the alcohol fumigation. So basically, initially the mixture is being carbureted, it is compressed, and at the end of the compression stroke we are injecting the diesel in the form of spray, and we are burning the mixture, whole mixture. So that is about the alcohol fumigation. Then we have alcohol diesel emulsion. In this alcohol diesel emulsion mode, we prepare a mixture of diesel and alcohol. And use it for our engine. So that is, we are preparing the emulsion of a diesel and alcohol. And instead of a pure diesel, we are using the emulsion as a fuel. Then we have our next method, what we call as surface ignition. Surface ignition. So in this method, in some location in the inside the engine, there is some heaters provided, and with the help of heaters, that regions are generally heated, and on this heated hot regions, fuel is sprayed and the heat helps in evaporation. And once it is evaporated and mixed with air, then that is going to be used for burning. So that is how we have here generally four methods. That is, in the dual fuel mode, we generally inject a small quantity of diesel, and then we have the injection of alcohol. Here we have a mixture of a carbureted mixture of alcohol and air is being produced, and we also inject around 50% of the diesel. In this, here we have alcohol diesel emulsion being prepared and used. Here on a hot surface, we are injecting the fuel and we are making that fuel to evaporate with the help of heat provided by the hot surface. So that is about using of alcohol in CI engines. Next, we can discuss about hydrogen. Obviously, hydrogen is also a fuel which can be considered as having a higher self ignition temperature. So hydrogen, it also have high self ignition temperature, and therefore if you want to use it, then we have to use it in a dual fuel mode. So here also we have to use it in a dual fuel mode. That is, air and hydrogen mixture is being introduced into the combustion chamber, and at the end of a compression stroke, we will be injecting some quantity of the diesel. And when the diesel pilot injection fuel, whatever is being introduced into the engine, starts burning, it produces heat, and the heat is used for burning the hydrogen. So hydrogen is also used as in a dual fuel mode. Then comes what we call as a biogas. So biogas is again an important fuel, which is generally we call it as a gober gas sometimes. And here aerobic and anaerobic digestion is taking place in what we call as a specially designed chamber, what we call as a digester. And this digestion is happening of the organic matter. So organic matter is fed into this chamber or digester in a regular manner, regular period, in a fixed quantity. And initially the digester is having some bacteria. So there are two chambers, preferably. In one we have what we call as aerobic bacteria, and another we have anaerobic bacteria. That is, one will be requiring oxygen for their living, and another live in the absence of oxygen. And this, therefore, in steps we have this particular digestion taking place. And in this process of decomposition of this organic matter, and what all organic matter we are using, we can use dung of animals like cow, buffalo, horse, pig, any of this particular animals dung we can use. We can use agricultural waste residues. It can be paddy waste, it can be wheat waste. Whatever residues we are producing due to agricultural waste, we can use it. Obviously, they according to the content, the amount of digestion period is going to different. Then we can use municipal waste. Municipal waste. Then we have the algae or any biological matter, feces, human feces, or so any of this particular biological waste can be used as a feed to this particular digestion. And this particular organic matter is digested in the process of anaerobic and aerobic digestion. And that will take around a period of time ranging from 14 to 21 days. And we will give sufficient time for the digestion to take place. And what happens in the during the digestion? Heavier hydrocarbons are broken into smaller hydrocarbons. And that is what we call as generally the digestion. And the product is preferably around more than 60% we have methane, and we will also get carbon dioxide. So this is the constituent of the biogas what we have. And lot of CO2 is also there. This methane will give some pungent smell to this particular gas. But methane is obviously a gaseous good fuel, and therefore it can be used as a fuel for engine also. Now, since we have methane, which is lighter hydrocarbon, it has a low calorific value. So this particular fuel has low calorific value. But we have the octane number to be higher. Octane number is higher. So when the octane number is higher, as we know, it is a poor CI engine, and therefore it has to be burned in the dual fuel mode. Is the most important fuel. So this has to be used in a dual fuel mode. So that is where we have a low calorific value, obviously, and therefore that means more quantity of fuel has to be burned. Octane number is higher, and the cetane number is therefore less, and obviously it can be burned, but dual fuel mode is going to be there. It can be used generally. It is not that always dual fuel. It can be used in a specifically designed engines also. It can be used. So that was about biogas. So we have a lot of biogas digester even in India we are using, but the feed has to be given a regularity. That is, regularly water and the feedstock has to be given to the digester in a regular manner, in a fixed quantity, and we will get a fixed biogas amount of biogas. But if there is a change in temperature, so there are so many parameters which affect the operation of the digestion, and therefore much of the biogas digesters used in India are presently not in a working proper working condition. Next gas what we have is producer gas, which is again a fuel for CI engine. So what is this producer gas? Generally we use here there is the producer gas is generated by flowing air and steam through coal and coke bed, coal or coke bed. So that is, we allow the air and steam to flow into this burning coal and coke, and so generally this is for this what we call as gasifiers are used. So specially designed gasifiers are generally used for producing the producer gas. So the biomass will be fed into the gasifier, and we will be supplying air and steam in a regular interval at a particular locations. There are certain regions where oxidation reaction is taking place, and there are certain regions where reduction reaction is taking place. Both oxidation and reaction reduction reactions are taking place. So during oxidation, O2, that is oxygen, is oxidizing the carbon to give CO2 in the oxidation zone, while the CO2 will be reduced to CO in the reduction zone. So in the reduction zone, so this is happening in oxidation zone, and this is happening in the reduction zone. So initially carbon is oxidized to carbon dioxide, then carbon dioxide is reduced to CO, and we know that CO is having a good fuel value. Now steam is also supplied. So steam, the water, is dissociated into H2 and O2, that is hydrogen and oxygen, and we know the hydrogen is also a very good fuel, and therefore here we have CO and hydrogen which are having the fuel values, and this gas is then therefore consisting of CO, H2, oxygen, and so many other gases also. And obviously, since we are burning the biomass, we are going to get we are going to have so many ash in the gas along with this. Therefore the gas has to be initially cleaned. It is coming out hot because all these particular gases are reactions are taking place, and the gasifier, the oxidation, the reduction reactions are happening at a very high temperatures, and therefore it is hot, so it has to be cooled, and it can be used in engines. But the calorific value of this particular fuel is again low. So this is about producer gas. Moving ahead, we have what we call as the next type of a gas, what we call as the blast furnace gas. Blast furnace gas. Now, what is this blast furnace gas? So we know that this particular blast furnace gas is a byproduct of steel plants. That is, they are being produced in the furnace when we produce iron. So when the iron is being produced in the furnace, it is being generated, it is being produced as a byproduct. So whatever the gases are coming out of the ore, so the ore is being melted and steel is being taken out of that, and in that particular ore there will be so many hydrocarbons, and this particular hydrocarbons are coming out, and therefore it consists mainly of carbon monoxide and nitrogen. So this constituents of the blast furnace gas, and obviously the calorific value is less, and here therefore it has to be initially cleaned, it has to be cooled, and then it has to be used. So that is about the blast furnace gas. Moving ahead, we have what we call as a coke oven gas. Coke oven gas. In the coke oven gas, it is basically a byproduct of when coke is produced from coal. So we know we generally heat under certain conditions, preferably in the absence of oxygen. We heat the coke, and during this particular heating, what happens is the lower hydrocarbons which are volatile, so those volatile hydrocarbons comes out under heat, and they are unable to burn because there is no oxygen. So this is generally what we call as a pyrolysis. So in the under pyrolysis conditions, this gases are being coming out from the coal. So what remains is the pure carbon, which we call as a coke, and the lower hydrocarbons and some hydrogen, that is hydrogen and methane are the constituents. Constituents of the coke oven gas, obviously they have low calorific value. So this is about the coke oven gas. And coming finally, we have what we call as biodiesels. Till now, whatever we discussed was except the alcohol, it was all gases. And this biodiesel is generally the diesel equivalent fuel produced from vegetable oils. So they are produced from vegetable oils. And what are the different vegetable oils used? It can be cottonseed, it can be coconut, we have sunflower oil, then we have rapeseed oil, then we have palm oil, we have karanji oil, jatropha oil. So there are so many almost all oils can be converted into diesel equivalent fuel. And the process what we used is generally what we call as transesterification process. So in this particular process, with the help of in the presence of alcohols. So this is a esterification process. Generally oils are fatty acids, and when we undergo this particular transesterification process, we get long chain esters, and this particular esters are generally having a viscosity equivalent to that of a diesel. So we have
almost viscosity equivalent to that of diesel fuel. Therefore, obviously we know that the oils can be burned. So since we have this particular this esterification is taking place in the presence of alcohols, what we get are ethyl or methyl esters. Ethyl esters or methyl esters. So this ethyl and methyl esters are generally having low viscosity to the equal to that of a diesel, because we know that oils are generally more viscous. Viscosity is more, and therefore we have to decrease the viscosity. So this when we go make convert into esters, these esters are having good calorific value equal to that of a diesel almost. Obviously different fuels will give different calorific value, and this is very simple to convert a vegetable oil into a ester by using esterification, transesterification process in the presence of alcohols. And this particular ethyl and methyl esters, whatever we produce, our properties are almost equivalent to that of diesel, and therefore we call them as biodiesels. This one of the problem with this biodiesel is that being a vegetable oil based, with time they change some properties, so that we cannot store them for a long time. And when they are burnt, that is, shelf life is lesser, and peculiar odor is there when burnt. That is, the smell, like when we fry something in a kitchen, whatever is there, such a odor is going to be there when we are burning this particular fuels in the engine also. So that becomes an issue when we use biodiesels as a fuel for CI engines. And this is one of the nowadays gaining a lot of popularity in countries like India, where we have different oils being produced in different regions, and we can convert this particular oils into diesel equivalent fuels, and they can be used. But obviously some viscosity problems are there, and sometimes this particular fuels may have some gummy deposits, and therefore the maintenance problem will increase. So such things has to be taken care before we use this particular fuels in CI engines. Thank you.